Welcome back. It's entirely possible that the world may never know why two young men decided to unleash an act of terror on unsuspecting American citizens. Questions abound. Answers may not be forthcoming. But are there indications to be drawn from what we do know about the background of the two brothers that could have led them to be allegedly involved in the bombing? Stephen Vannevera is the Ford International Professor at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology Political Science Department. Professor Vannevera joins us now from Lexington, Mass. Professor, we heard from their peers, the brothers' peers, that these suspects lived quite normal lives in the U.S. How could they possibly get so radicalized?
Well, it's starting to look. The picture that's emerging is that they got radicalized online, that they somehow found a radical Islamist message online and let themselves get persuaded by it. It may be also true that the older brother then went to Russia, and he may or may not, we don't know, have met people in person who furthered the process along. But I think we're seeing, at least the thing that is becoming quite clear, is that we're seeing an online radicalization event here.
Professor Vannevera, there's an association here with Chechnya. And we do know that Chechnya is a troubled part of the world. But a lot of that trouble is directed at Russia because of the atrocities that earlier Russian regimes perpetrated in that area. Why would Chechenian problems be visited on American soil?
Great question. What we're seeing here is something we've seen in other Muslim areas that have suffered civil war or invasion. What we've seen in Chechnya, and we also saw it in Afghanistan, is that the people who are losing the civil war invite al-Qaeda in to help them. And that's what happened in Afghanistan. That's how bin Laden's folks originally got a foothold in Afghanistan. They went in there to help the Taliban against the Northern Alliance. In Chechnya, same story. The Chechen anti-Russian resistance were in desperate shape, and they invited al-Qaeda in to help them. Then al-Qaeda used that opportunity to gain a foothold there and recruit Chechens. And then we saw Chechens being recruited into al-Qaeda action elsewhere around South Asia and the Middle East.
Professor, there are those that want to position this attack on Boston, the Boston Marathon, as something other than terrorism. What do you make of that?
I think it's just wrong. This is a very standard, vanilla-flavored terrorist attack. We've seen quite a number of them that are just like this. In the U.S. already. The Hassan attack on Fort Hood, the underwear bomber, the attempted bombing of Times Square, they were all committed by people who've been radicalized online. In those cases, they were radicalized by a preacher named Anwar al-Awlaki, who is now dead. In this case, it looks like these guys were radicalized by an Australian preacher who I had not heard of before. His name is Faiz Muhammad. And he preaches a slightly different twist on the whole al-Qaeda narrative. He's got a story he tells about folks from Central Asia being the Islamic army that will produce the great triumph that will lead to the end times. But it's still the same narrative. It's a victim narrative, very motivating narrative, the al-Qaeda narrative. If you believe this narrative, you'd be wanting to put bombs in buildings and kill people too. The bottom line here, by the way, is these attacks like this, are going to continue until the world addresses this narrative. It's a very motivating narrative. It's a false narrative. I think the U.S. government has not worked hard enough to address it and destroy it.
Well, that's a question I'd like to follow up on then. What can be done in terms like this? Because we're talking about a radicalization of people that don't look like the supposed ideal terrorist. We're talking about the blue-eyed, blonde-haired terrorist here that can pretty much infiltrate anywhere.
That's correct. It's very hard to find domestic American folks who've been radicalized online. You can't stop them at the border because they're already in the country. And detecting their radicalization process is hard unless you happen to stumble across it online. I think there's two takeaways from this policy-wise. Number one, the United States government should put much more money and skill into public diplomacy, into arguing about how the world works with folks overseas. The U.S. government used to do this and used to do it well. During World War II, Roosevelt invested a lot in public diplomacy and shaping opinion overseas. And then in the early Cold War, the U.S. did too. But the Congress very, very foolishly basically dismantled America's arguing apparatus the U.S. public diplomacy apparatus in the 1990s, and they need to restore it. We now spend very little money on what people call public diplomacy, but basically means efforts to shape the terms of debate overseas. My view is we have an unduly militarized way of dealing with the terror problem, and we need to realize that it all, dealing with terror also requires arguing and debating and discussing and sharing thoughts and treating other people like grown-ups.
Professor Vannevera, there's a greater discussion to be had here, but unfortunately we're running short on time. But I thank you for your time this morning. I look forward to speaking with you again.
Hey, it's really been great. Thanks for calling.
It's our pleasure.
You well.
You be well. That was Professor Stephen Vannevera, and he joined us from Lexington, Massachusetts. He's a professor of political science at MIT.